Good morning, and welcome to First Baptist Church on the Square here in Burnsville. Delighted that you could be with us, either in person or online. There's lots of opportunities this afternoon. We'd love for you to stick around after the benediction, and Steve James will be sharing about his experience in the Ukraine. And I know that you'll want to do that. And at the same time, you'll be able to enjoy some pastries and coffee and then offer a love gift to the youth as they try to raise money for their summer passport trip in Greensboro this year. So let me encourage you to do that. We're also asking folks to stay even a little longer. We're going to be raking leaves off of our raised beds so that we can begin planting in just a few weeks. It's hard to believe, isn't it, that spring crops can go in the ground and March. And we need, just think, if we had 10 people that would stay for 30 minutes instead of one person staying half a day. If you're willing to do that, we would greatly appreciate it, even if you could do 15 minutes, even 20 minutes. All right, do I hear an hour? I hear an hour. I got an hour. We'll have a wonderful time, and the temperatures, I'm really trying to sell this, you know. The temperatures are going to be a balmy 54 degrees today. Remember that we also, if you pay attention, there are several other things in the back of the bulletin. I'm not going to read them to you. So just take a moment to look over those. Most of all, just let me say how grateful I am that you're here. There's lots of other places you could be today. Thank you for choosing worship here at First Baptist Church. Let's take a moment and just relax, to make ourselves fully present. Pay attention to your breathing. And just feel like you're at home. Let's worship together.
Good morning. Please join me in the call to worship. God welcomes the dreamers and the doubters, the courageous and the fearful, the hungry and the hopeful, the impatient and the reserved. God welcomes the young and the old, the poets and the prophets, the faithful and the tired. Wherever you are on your journey, wherever your boat is at sea,
there is room for all together here.
This is God's house.
Let us worship the one whom even the seas obey.
Thanks be to God.
Good morning. This morning for our opening prayer, I would encourage you to keep your eyes open instead of closing them. And what I would like you to focus on or look at is the artwork that's displayed up here. And I would encourage you to allow yourself to notice where your eyes being drawn. What parts of this piece did you quickly look over? What emotions does this art evoke within you? This piece is titled Lift Off, And the artist writes, "There are no streetlights in the ocean." I think about that often. Rarely do we think about how dark and mysterious the night is, even for veteran fishermen. Nor do we take into consideration the moment of the wind, its roar and rumbling of the waves. Keep your eyes open as you hear these words. "I'd rather not need rescue. I'd prefer a 5-step plan, a quick fix solution. I'd prefer stubborn insistence over honest vulnerability, because rescue requires asking for help. Rescue names the rising water. Rescue sees the tired, treading feet. Rescue feels the swell of the wind and the rain at a slant. But when the floor falls out, when the world is on fire, and my small hands cannot fix the hurt welling up inside me, the prayer that slips out is rescue. Rescue. Rescue me." Amen.
Good morning. Our opening song is on the insert in your bulletin. It's called "Into the Waters." Won't you please rise in body or spirit?
Thank you.
I walked into one of the rooms upstairs this week. I do this occasionally and spoke to the folks from AA meeting in one of the rooms. And they said, Pastor, thank you so much. And I said, well, for what? For allowing us this nice space. We can gather here every week. It's warm. We're dry. Thank you. And I said, I'm really not the person to thank. But I will tell our stockholders. Because without you and these offerings, AA would not be upstairs. I did say to them that I think I speak on behalf of this congregation and that we support the mission of AA, of healing, of recovery. I mean, after all, that's why we're here. So I'm here to say thank you. Every bit of your contribution is used, I hope and pray, as a part of healing, as a part of restoration for all of God's beloved people. Amen. I'd like to invite the children to come with their time with Donna Sink.
I'm going to ask you some questions, and then we're going to talk about a story in the Bible, and then we're going to come back to what we were talking about. Okay, so the first thing that I want to ask you is, have you ever seen somebody doing something that looked really cool and really easy, and you were like, I can totally do that, and so you tried it, What do you think? Like, what about a sport? Have you ever seen somebody like playing something? You're like, whoa, that looks good. They can do that. I'm sure I can, right? And so you try. Juliet's like, nope, not me. What about something else? Let's say, so I know that your mom does some acting things, right? So have you ever thought, well, those people are making acting look really easy, right? Maybe I can do that. What do you think? Have you thought about it? Has it been harder than you thought? Have you tried something because somebody made it look easy and then it was a little bit harder than you thought? Yeah, that happens to me quite often. because somebody else has made it look easy, and so I'm like, I can do that. But then the moment I start to doubt, like, whether I actually can, or I start to feel a little bit scared. Barrett, have you ever felt scared once you started to do something? Not yet. I believe that, actually. Barrett and I know each other pretty well, and I definitely believe that. So we're going to talk about a story in the Bible, and it's actually a story full of miracles that Jesus was doing, but we're not going to talk about the miracles Jesus did. We're actually going to talk about a guy named Peter who honestly kind of rode on the coattails of Jesus's miracles, okay? So one time Jesus had fed a bunch of people with just a little bit of food, and then he was like, you know what, I need a little space. And so he said, take me across the lake and let me go by myself up to a mountain and pray. And he did that. And while he was doing that, his disciples, which are kind of like his best friends, right? They stayed out in the boat on the lake, and it got super windy and everything. But when Jesus was ready to come back, he walked on top of the water, which isn't normal, right? So that's a miracle in itself. He just trotted on out there, even though it was kind of windy and waves. He just trotted on out there on that water. And Peter saw him, and Peter was like, that's cool. And he makes it look easy. He was like, call me to you. Let me come to you, Jesus. And he said, sure, come on. And so Peter hopped out of the boat and started walking on the water too. How cool is that? But guess what happened to Peter that didn't happen to Jesus? Peter was doing fine, right? Until he looked down and he saw the waves under his feet. And he, in a moment, he started to get scared, and he started to doubt the choice that he made. Like, he was like, wait, I don't know that I can do this. But what he forgot was that he wasn't doing it. Who was doing it? Jesus was doing it. That's right. And so he was like, oh no, Jesus, save me. And Jesus said, why are you doubting? Have little faith. And of course, Jesus reached out his hand, pulled Peter up into the boat, and everything was fine. But what we need to learn from the story and from Peter is that when we do try something, lots of times our fear, right, once we start it, I think of riding a bike, right? Because I don't know if you've learned to ride a bike yet, but when it's very common when you get pretty good and whoever's teaching you lets go of the back and you don't know they let go, you're still fine until you turn around, right? And you're like, oh no, I'm on my own. And you feel this moment of fear. And then you start to wobble, okay? But what we need to learn from Peter is that that doubt and that fear, while it's natural, we always need to look to Jesus because he can uphold us, right? He can help us out. There's gonna be big things in our life, okay, whether it's deciding where we want to go to school or what job we want or if we want to stay in a committed relationship, like things like that where we're gonna be like, yeah, this is great. And then we'll be like, wait a minute, is this great? Right? And then we need to remember Jesus saying, wait, why are you doubting? Have faith. Not necessarily faith in ourselves, although our self-confidence keeps us brave and adventurous, right? But when it gets really hard, we need to be like, oh, that's right. I'm not doing it. Jesus is holding me up. Can we try to remember that with the big things? All right, let's say a little prayer. Dear God, thank you so much for sending us such a great example in your Son of someone who has tremendous faith and who upholds us and asks us to have faith in him. In your name I pray. Amen.
I am so taken with the intro of the children's sermon and also with the opening hymn. I just looked down at some of the words and I thought, how wonderful. This is taking us right into the scripture. In the opening hymn, I spotted fear, lakes, waves, storms, distress, boat, all of them getting us ready for the scripture reading, and I'm very grateful for that. Our text tells us of Peter's attempts to walk on the stormy sea. It's the Sea of Galilee, which is located on the Jordan River. We see on a map of Israel, the Jordan River starts way north of Israel, and it's near the Mount Hermon range. It's snow-capped, and the elevation is 9,223 feet above sea level, of course. The Jordan River flows almost directly north and south until it forms the Sea of Galilee, and farther downstream, it forms the Dead Sea, a journey of about 156 miles. Israel is on the west side of the Jordan, and the country of Jordan is on the east side. The Jordan feeds the lowest freshwater lake on earth, the Sea of Galilee. This Sea of Galilee is situated 700 feet below sea level. Farther south, the Jordan flows into the Dead Sea, a salt lake that is 1,300 feet below sea level. Today's text tells of a frightening storm happening as the disciples tried to reach Bethsaida on the upper west side of the lake. Scientists tell us why these sudden violent storms still happen. Since the Sea of Galilee is about 700 feet below sea level, the lake at times gets very warm. Cold air rushing down from the surrounding hillsides clashes with the warm air. Cold air clashes with warm air, and the result is violent storms. It is on these stormy waves that Peter tries to walk. Matthew 14:22-33. Immediately, Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side, while he dismissed the crowd. After he had dismissed them, he went up on the mountainside by himself to pray. Later that night, he was there alone, and the boat was already a considerable distance from land, buffered by the waves, because the wind was against it. Shortly before dawn, Jesus went out to them. walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. "It's a ghost," they said, and cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, "Take courage, it is I. Don't be afraid." "Lord, if it is you," Peter replied, "tell me to come to you on the water." "Come," he said. Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid and was beginning to sink. He cried out, "Lord, save me!" Immediately, Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. "You of little faith," he said, "why did you doubt?" And when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down. Then those who were in the boat worshiped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
You may have heard the old riddle. What's the difference between you and God? God never thinks he's you. Matthew seems to refer to the Psalms that it's darkest before the dawn. That's not really true, by the way. But it sure seems like it. Maybe it ought to be true. But it's not. Storm was raging. Boat was rocking. Waves crashing. Matthew says the wind was against them. They were right out there in those deep waters. And you know, if you've ever been out on the water, you've been in deep waters. It's not the place you want to be. They were accustomed to storms, but maybe not like this one. And I'm almost sure that while everything was stacked against them, can you imagine what the conversation was like on the boat? I mean, people just being people out there in a storm. That would have been, it'd be really interesting. Hey, Matthew, could you tell us what they were talking about while that storm was raging? But Matthew only leaves that to your imagination and to mine. I'm pretty sure that they weren't slapping each other on the back saying, man, we're living our best life now. Isn't this wonderful? Following Jesus. But Matthew says Jesus was out there too. Jesus was on the water. He was coming to them, but they just, well, they couldn't make him out. And we know that to be true about storms. You really can't see very far. You can't see very clearly. Visibility is always at its lowest. And on top of that, well, mix in some fear. Well, maybe a lot of it. And you know, fear does what fear always does. It confuses, it distorts. No one's able to see things as they really are during a storm. And God knows during a storm, our minds don't often take us to a good place. We live through some Category 1 storms while living on the North Carolina coast, and several tropical storms. It was a challenge living with my wife during those storms. That's why we're in Western North Carolina now. Thanks be to God. But I have to say, we weren't feeling so warm and fuzzy during those storms. I mean, when your home is battered with 90-mile-an-hour gusts, you can just kind of hear the rafters creaking. And you can look out the back window of our home. We did. We watched the storm and saw trees bending almost like we've never seen them bend before. And then the rain is blowing sideways and the lights are flickering. And that brings a lot of uncertainty. I've never met a person that really said, I enjoy uncertainty. I enjoy it. That's just not who we are. Now, did you get that small little hint in the very beginning of the text? The fact that these disciples were out there wasn't really their idea. Jesus said to do this. Jesus told them to do this. Yeah, we just have so much in common with these disciples. Oh, I know we don't like to admit it, but we are so much like them, we just don't really enjoy uncertainty. We feel better when we camp out under the illusion that we have some control over something. What do you have control over in your life? If you're real honest, I'd say that we would all admit not much. Well, it's hard to miss Peter in the text, isn't it? The church, maybe you and I have always had a love-hate relationship with Peter. In fact, Peter doesn't look very good in two of the synoptic gospels. He doesn't fare very well in Matthew. You and I may even read into the text thinking, poor old Peter. He can't get it right. He just can't get it right. He puts his foot in his mouth. He says things without thinking. He does things he shouldn't do. Poor old Peter. He ought to know better. It's just so easy to look at Peter with our self-righteous glasses, with the lens that we have formed over the years. We would do so much better than Peter. And we fail to see at times that we are like Peter. Here in this text, what do you think? How's he look? Does he look like a strong, wonderful Christian? Or does he seem kind of foolish? You have to decide that. I have some ideas. I'd say the first thing we should do is just say, well, let's just take our self-righteous glasses off for a moment. Would you? Could we? As the storm is raging with those winds blowing, what does he do? He jumps out of the boat. You ever been in a boat when somebody jumped out of it? How'd you feel about it? You're like, thank you very much. We were already rocking and rolling. And when somebody jumps out of a boat, it doesn't get calmer. Things doesn't get better. What's he thinking? Jumping out of the boat like that. Or was he thinking? Say what? He was doing. We'd rather get in church and just think, or maybe not. I mean, we've not often been confused with people who think. The church, thinking or doing. Maybe we struggle at both. And I wonder why he did it. I wonder why he did it. Was he trying to prove something to the disciples? Did he jump out of the boat to impress Jesus? And can you imagine the conversation after he jumps out? what those disciples were saying. Wouldn't you have loved to have been a fly on the wall on the side of the boat? I wonder if they were saying what were they saying when he jumped? Well, I'm sure it wasn't very good. Or at least that's what I think. Because if you've ever really, not literally, but spiritually jumped out of a boat, sometimes people inside the boat don't always understand you. And they will question you. People inside the boat will question you. I love that Peter does so well for a moment. He had a moment. He must have felt so good for a moment. But that moment didn't last, did it? Because they never do. We like to hold on to moments like that. But you can't hold on very tightly. Because like Peter, we do begin to sink. That's just what happens. No matter how hard we try in life, you're just not going to be able to walk on water very long, spiritually speaking. Outside the boat, we see Peter sinking. And that's where I think we often feel like Peter on the journey. Those sinking moments. I guess you've had some. If you haven't, then you probably will. You're probably going to have some moments. Because that's what life does. Even to the very best people. Even with those with the best intentions. For many people, it just seems like most days, a lot of days, you talk to people that just feel like they're sinking. They're just sinking. They have many moments of sinking feelings. I have to say to you that I think at that moment, Peter's at his very best. That's what I think. I think Peter is at his very best when he's sinking down in the waters. Maybe the text doesn't seem to suggest it, or maybe it's the way we read into the text, but I think Peter is at his very best. It's a beautiful moment. Sure is. Because in that moment, Peter cries out. He cries out for help. I really love Anne Lamont. You know, Anne Lamont struggled with alcoholism for many years. She found recovery, and she's one of the greatest authors I've ever read. And she says, you know, there's only three prayers. When you boil everything down, there's only three. Help, thanks, and wow. She writes, when I have run out of good ideas on how to fix the unfixable, when we finally stop trying to heal our own sick, stressed minds with our sick, stressed minds, when we are truly at the end of our rope and just done, we all say the same prayer. we say help. Most good, honest prayers remind me that I am not in charge, that I can't fix anything, and that I open myself up to being helped by something, some force, some friend, some something. These prayers say, dear some something, I don't know what I'm doing. I can't see where I'm going. I'm getting more lost, more afraid, more clenched. Help. Help. It's a great prayer. It's a great prayer. Help. I have to admit that I'm not really all that good at that. I'm really better with the other narrative. I'm good. I can handle this. You can talk to Jennifer. I lift things I shouldn't lift. Because I don't want to call you. I don't want to bother you. I say, I can do it. I don't need your help. Self-sufficient. I got it. I don't like asking for it. I'm working on it. I know that most of that lies deep within me. Contrary to popular opinion, don't you love the story? Because Peter at his very best cries out for help. And Jesus meets him. And contrary to popular opinion, Jesus doesn't go over to Peter and say, now, Peter, you've got just a few more seconds here. Quickly repeat the sinner's prayer. Jesus doesn't rush over to Peter and say, Peter, hurry up, do the Roman road. Peter, you're a sinner. Peter, you're worthless. Peter, you're... Look at the text. He doesn't ask for a confession. I love that about Jesus. Because when you're sinking in water, you don't need theology or doctrine. You need a hand of love and compassion. And I'm sorry that people make God out to be something God isn't. You know, when you and I come to the realization that we cannot save ourselves, that we cannot pull up ourselves by our own bootstraps, we cry out. We cry out for help. Have you ever done that? Cry out for help. I remember asking my father, who had a brain aneurysm at 59 and we didn't know if he was going to live. He spent 6 weeks in ICU at Baptist Hospital, and much of that was in a coma. Miraculously, my father survived. He was never the same. Not after a storm like that. He got home, and when he had recovered as much as he could recover, I said, "Dad, what was it like to be in a coma for all those weeks?" And he said to me, "Son, it was a dark road." He said, "It was a lonely place." But he said, I felt somebody's hand on my back. And he said, I tried to turn around and see who it was. Who was it that was touching my back?" He said, you know, I never could make it out. I couldn't make out who it was. He said, "Son, I'm sure it was Jesus. I'm sure it was Jesus. It was Jesus," he said. And we sat there in the living room, both of us just crying. Not tears of sadness, but tears of gratitude, because in sinking moments, we can hold on to a hand that comes to us. Not in condemnation, but in rescue. I wonder if we could be so foolish in the midst of a storm that seems like we're in, to be so foolish to just jump out of the boat. You know, I think the world is waiting for the church to get out of the boat. The church needs to meet the world outside of the boat, which you know means no longer playing it safe. No longer playing it safe. Why don't we just be so foolish to jump out of the boat? Alex Navalny jumped out of the boat. Returned to Russia. Sadly, his life was taken because he jumped out of the boat. I think it's true that we are at our best when we're sinking. Richard Rohr writes about when we're sinking, because we realize our frailty, understand our own vulnerability. Paul wrote it this way: "When I am weak, then I'm strong." You know, those people that pretend they're really strong and powerful. You know those people? It's not true. It simply isn't true. The strongest people in the world are the sinkers that cry out. They cry out for help. Well, seems like a good day to do it. I mean, winds are blowing, aren't they? Storms raging. Anne Lamott writes this prayer. I want you to listen to it as I wrap this thing up. She says, "Hi, God. I'm just a mess. It's all hopeless. What else is new? I would be sick of me if I were you, but miraculously you're not. I know I have no control over other people's lives, and I hate this. Yet I believe that if I accept this surrender, you will meet me wherever I am." Wow. Can this be true? If so, how was this afternoon, say, two-ish? Thank you in advance for your company and blessings. You've never once let me down. Think about the times when you've cried out. I thought about them as I wrote the sermon. Times in my journey when me and my family jumped out of the boats. And those moments when we were sinking. In those moments when we've cried out, when my father cried out, I didn't see it then. I didn't even know it. But the hand of compassion was there. I can see it now. And I can say to you, thanks be to God, I've never really prayed that prayer when it wasn't answered. I've never once really cried out for help when somehow, in some way, the hand of compassion was there. So I'm urging you and myself to be a little bit more like Peter. Let's be foolish. Let's look weak. Let's cry out. Let's ask for help, because we don't have this like we think we do. Save us. Save us. Let's look a little bit like Peter. We'll be at our very best. And today, if we do it today, it'd be a heck of a day.
Our closing song can be found on the insert, "Stand By Me." Won't you please rise in body or spirit?
Upon the
Receive now this benediction. Beloved wanderer, as you leave this place, may you carry your curious heart on your sleeve. May you look for God in every face. May you find the courage to get out of the boat, to run to the tomb, and to speak of your faith. And when the world falls apart, may you hear God's voice deep within, saying, "Take heart, it is I. Be not afraid. You are called, you are blessed. In both your ups and your downs, you always belong to God. Go now in peace. Go trusting that good news." Amen.